Could there be a better place to launch a report by leading American and Chinese universities, USC and Peking University, on building U.S.-China trust through next-generation people, platform, and programs? No, there could not be a better place. This report was 2 years in preparation, but it's as fresh as this morning's headlines. The report's presentation of constructive and worrisome dynamics in U.S.-China relations echoes the issue that President Obama is dealing with in his current trip to Asia. While President Obama is not visiting China this time around, China is the subtext of many of his conversations in Japan, South Korea, Malaysia, and the Philippines. One of President Obama's goals is to reassure friends and allies in the region that the U.S. has the means and the will to remain a force for stability and prosperity in the Asia Pacific. Those assurances, however, risk reinforcing the sense of some in China that the U.S. aims to staunch its rise and embolden nations with which it has territorial disputes. In other words, President Obama has a tough job. He needs to navigate and seek to alleviate the atmosphere of mistrust that pervades too many aspects of U.S.-China engagement. Those are my personal views. I also think they're the views of those of us here and others on this panel who worry about the problems in the U.S.-China relationship and hope it will improve. This is the best place to launch this report. Maybe the only better place would have been on Air Force One before the president took off, but we know he'll hear about what we talk to here. As I mentioned, through our Kissinger Institute on China and the U.S., and our Asia program, we reach policymakers and publics in both the U.S. and China. In fact, through the Kissinger Institute's bilingual programs, we're able to reach people in both languages, English and Mandarin. And Robert Daly, in case you don't know this, starred in a major Chinese soap opera. He played the American, but his Chinese language skills are reputed to be the best ever by a non-native Chinese speaker. So try him out. And next time you're in town, we'll be happy to convene a Chinese-speaking audience for the launch of the Mandarin edition of this report, which Robert is preparing right now. That audience would include not only scores of influential Chinese who promote constructive bilateral relations here in Washington, but it would also include the scores of young Americans in a range of professions who have years of experience in China and who do bring language skills and cultural knowledge to their careers. Back in my day, nobody learned foreign languages. Now, scores of U.S. children want to learn Chinese, and that's a very exciting and, I think, a positive development. So, giving young bilingual scholars and professionals a chance to meet in institutions like this one to discuss reports like yours is one of the most effective ways we have of building trust. So, thanks to the Annenberg School and Peking University for partnering with the Wilson Center for this important program, and thanks to all of you for joining us. My colleagues look forward to discussing these issues with you at the reception that follows, and the Wilson Center looks forward to future collaborations with the University of Southern California and with BEIDA. So BEIDA, in case some of you don't know, means Peking University is called BEIDA. Did everybody know that? Raise your hand if you... let down. So welcome to all. I think... Clayton, you're the next act, and I again want to thank our colleagues and thank my colleagues, both Ambassador Roy and Dr. Daly for the enormous work they do here. Thank you.
As Jane Harmon just told you, the answer to the question of where should a report like this be launched is here, right here at the Wilson Center. We're delighted to be here. We hope to be on Air Force One next time, and you know, our fingers crossed on that. Today. We have a number of speakers, and partly to save time and partly to ensure that we don't leave out some of their major achievements, we provided introductions to the speakers in the program. And so you might want to refer to that. And of course, we hope that everybody picked up on the way in a copy of the report that we are launching today. It's a great privilege to be here in Washington before this audience, as well as the one that's online. And we look forward to your questions. We look forward to your suggestions. in the Q&A portion. And so we'll have ample time for you to raise questions and also to talk informally at the reception that follows. It's a great privilege to be here. And this is an important topic. The relationship between the United States and China, I don't really need to tell this audience, is central. Central not just for the people of our two countries. Obviously, it matters a great deal to us, but it matters to the entire world because of our outsized impact on that world. Just to remind you of a couple ways that our two countries, influence the world, we have some charts. First, and we'll come back to this, this is the commission that Dean Wilson will be talking about in a moment. But here we see the population of the world. Roughly one out of four people are Chinese or American. Our two countries, just by themselves, constitute a quarter of the world's population. In terms of global gross domestic product, economic output, our two countries hit above our population weight. We are, of course, the first and second largest economies and produce about one-third of the value of all goods and services produced anywhere. In terms of trade, we are responsible for about a fourth of global trade. In defense spending, we also hit way above our weight. This chart is slightly out of date. It's from 2012. If you use today's statistic, you would see that the share of global defense spending from the United States has declined slightly to 38%. Very slightly. But the share of Chinese defense spending of the global total has risen to about 11%. And what that means is our two countries are responsible for roughly half of all the defense spending in the world. But here too, we hit way above our belt. If you want to look at which two countries are doing the most to change the climate for today and for tomorrow, it's our two countries. China with about 27% of global greenhouse gases, and the United States with about 17%. So together, 44% of all the greenhouse gases being produced are being produced by our two countries. So clearly, we have an enormous impact. Now later, we'll come back and look at a few other statistics, and more important, we'll look at a new website, a new database on U.S.-China exchanges. But before we do that, we're going to hear from the two chairs of the commission, focusing on trust building and relationship enhancing. First, we have Dean Ernest Wilson from the Annenberg School for Communication, and then we'll be hearing from Dean Jia Qingguo, who is the head of Beijing University's School for International Studies. Friends, let's welcome them.
First of all, I want to thank Jane Harmon for her generosity in allowing us to come and share this message and information with you. She has been an inspiration for those of us not only at USC, but all up and down California as a representative. She is also, of course, the CEO and president of this great organization. And more importantly, she's my boss, because she is a trustee of the University of Southern California, and so I report to her. But I really do want to thank you for your generosity and your greetings. On the way in, I had the opportunity to stop and look at those wonderful quotations downstairs on the ground floor. And the words of Woodrow Wilson resonate very clearly and very importantly with the mission of this binational commission. And I'm going to tell you a little bit about the binational commission. I'm going to tell you why we formed this thing in the first place. But let me jump to the punchline. The punchline is as follows. And that is that if you look at financial transactions, economic and trade transactions, tourism, and the strategic interaction between the United States and the People's Republic of China, you see a trend line that looks like this. It's going up dramatically. We have never been more integrated than we are today. If you look at polls like the Pew Trust polls and others, and you look at the trust between the people of our two great countries, it's going in the opposite direction, substantially. Our integration with one another, our trust toward one another, we think that's a problem. We think it's an urgent problem. Unfortunately, it's one of those urgent problems that can be can address short-term issues, but the payoff is in the long term. But where better to think about long-term issues than in a think tank like this one? Let me tell you just very, very briefly about the history of the commission. The commission brings together five prominent American citizens and five prominent Chinese citizens. And we were worried about this scissor effect, especially around 2012, because during elections, as you know, the Americans tend to say sort of bad things about the Chinese, and the Chinese, during their transitions, tend to say charged things about the United States for political reasons. And we thought that would happen, and we wanted to use that as a base to build a longer-term relationship of trust. Let me just suggest to you some long and medium term and short term reasons why we got engaged in this in the first place. In the short term, the debate between the two countries, and our commission traveled to Beijing and their commissioners came to Washington and we met people at the Pentagon and State Department, USTR, et cetera, et cetera. Too many of the conversations were about cybersecurity, exchange rates, direct foreign investment, the three islands. Said that three times. We believe that those are important issues to be addressed, but they must be balanced with other activities and engagements that are taking place between the United States and China. So there are short-term issues that are very important, that if we only talk about the bad stuff, to put it bluntly, and don't look at the other kinds of educational exchanges, city to city, women's organizations, chambers of commerce, et cetera, then it's an unbalanced picture of the relationship. And in the conversations we had at State and across the United States, it was only one side of the picture that was discussed. Some research that we did, and Clay Duby, I want to thank him for his work in this area, we began to count the number of non-governmental, non-official organizations in the United States that have relationships with China. There are 300 of them, but we don't talk about that. And so therefore, the short-term debate is a very charged one. We believe also in the media, so those are short-term issues. If we can build up trust in the short term, just by expanding the scope of debate, we believe it may lead to more robust strategies between the two countries. Secondly, very quickly, in the medium term, and this I would refer to China's rise and U.S. current position as the leading economic and political power. Traditionally, as everyone in this room knows, that when you have that kind of changing structural situation, it has in the past, not inevitably, but sometimes leads to conflict. And therefore, we don't want conflict, but that we believe can be assuaged and helped by having a more balanced approach to the bilateral relationship between the United States and China. Long term, we believe that this kind of relationship is simply not sustainable, either logically, if you think about it, or historically, that gap, that trust gap, is a very serious one, and that it's one that needs to be addressed. So let me just conclude this part of the discussion by suggesting to you that and I hope you will look at, we'll actually take a look at the very carefully drafted report. This is going to be a long-term slog. It's a long-term strategy. Changing attitudes, changing values cannot be done overnight. But we have to start to build for this generation and the next generation. And I would also say, because I do remember my time on the National Security Council and other institutions in town, we often pay less attention. We discount the long-term future. But if we don't get this right in the short term, I would suggest that there could be short-term consequences in our strategic negotiations and our economic negotiations between the two countries. We'll come back toward the end and talk about what we propose, but we want to at least set the stage for you at the start. Thank you.
One of the key questions that we are facing today is why China and the U.S., the two great countries, while they are getting closer together, they develop more strategic distrust. Yeah. I was thinking of a married couple. You get married, you get closer, and then you fight fiercer battles all the time. You know? I think that's too simple to explain this situation. Personally, I believe that probably there are a few factors involved. One is that China's rising. Okay. As a result of China's rising, China has become number one in terms of GDP. Will be number one according to the economic projections. But of course, the Chinese know better it's a long way before China really catches up with the U.S. Not just in terms of GDP, but in many other aspects. But as China rises, China is second to only one country in the eyes of a lot of people. Okay, that's a problem, especially when it is also the impression of the Americans. Okay? They are also worried about the rise of China. If you look at the headlines, sometimes you get the impression that China has already overtaken the U.S., not in the Chinese language newspapers, but in the U.S. or Western language newspapers. So people get worried. And of course, if you look at history, then the rising power and established power, they develop conflicts, they enter into war. So people think that this may be the thing that we are going to embrace. Professor Mearsheimer of Chicago University, he said, you know, this is the tragedy of great power politics. It's like a Greek tragedy, you know. You know that you are going to embrace that kind of end, and then you try to avoid it, but in the end you get into it anyway. People are worried about this. And not only the Americans, but also the Chinese. When the Americans are worried, they adopt hedging strategies. Okay, and the Chinese, when they look at the American hedging strategies, they are thinking, "Oh, what the hell? What's going on? You know, what the Americans are up to?" Okay, when Obama announces a pivot strategy, then the Chinese were saying, "Oh, Obama is trying to contain China." At least some Chinese are saying this. That's the first reason. Okay. The second reason is that, you know, there are a lot of people in both countries. They don't know the other country. They haven't traveled to the other country. They haven't talked to people of the other country. They have developed over the years a lot of prejudices about the other country. Some people, for example, in the U.S. do think that China is a country like the former Soviet Union, okay? A communist country of that type. Okay? But of course, China has moved away from that in a big way. It's a very different country. If you stay in China now, you know it's very different. China has not only changed in terms of economically, but also in terms of values. Okay? China has embraced the market economy, the idea of rule of law, even the idea of human rights and democracy. You know, a prominent Chinese official wrote this article saying, democracy is a good thing, you know. And he got away with it. Apparently, a lot of people, including the high-ranking officials of the Chinese Communist Party, believe that democracy is a good thing, you know. Of course, our conditions are different. Democracy needs to be practiced differently. But democracy as a value is already accepted in China. Okay? But a lot of people don't know this in this country. So they, of course, a lot of people in China don't know this. So there are a lot of misunderstandings about each other. Okay? When the Americans criticize China, Chinese fight back. Okay? And then there is a tendency of on part of the media to amplify the negative things about the two countries. Okay? You hear an incident here and there, a conflict here and there between the two countries, and then this became big news. Okay. I'm sure, you know, today's launching of this book, this report, a product of our collaboration, would not get the same media attention. Okay? But a nasty incident would be the headline of the day. Okay? So a lot of people get the impression that the relationship is not good. It's quite bad. Okay, this is not true. Okay, but this the impression people get. Okay, and finally, there is a tendency on the part of the officials, okay, to be firm. Okay, to take a tough position on the other side. Okay, it's domestically popular, and politically correct. Okay, and that also create make things a little bit worse, appear a little bit worse between the two countries. Okay, all I want to say is that there are important factors that influence our way of thinking, conceptualization of the state of affairs between the two countries. Okay. I should say, after many years of study of this relationship, the relationship has never been better. Of course, our concerns have never been worse. But anyway, I believe that through our joint efforts, we want to shift people's attention to the positive side a little bit more, and to encourage people to make efforts to push the relationship in the positive direction a little bit more. Okay? And I hope that this is our objective can be realized, or in part because of our contributions. Thank you.
Thank you. You'll hear a little bit more from Deans Wilson and Jha in just a moment. But you folks, of course, are very much part of building this relationship. There are those of you in the audience who have put together cultural exchanges, scholarly exchanges, and we look forward to your comments. But first, we're going to hear from one of the most influential China scholars in the United States, somebody who has also served in government. We have with us Professor Susan Shirk.
I am not Susan Shirk. Alas. But I failed to do two things. One is to thank my co-chair, Dean Jha, who just spoke. I think the commission really practiced what we preached. And I did want to acknowledge he flew all the way from China for this event, and he really has been a wonderful supporter. I also failed in my second duty to point out that Susan Shirk is also a member of the commission. And I wanted to make sure that that was on the record, in addition to being the chair of the 21st Century China program at UC San Diego.
Well, yes, I'm also a Californian, but at University of California, San Diego, but I am a big fan of the U.S. China Institute at USC, and we look for every opportunity to work together on different topics. Our program on 21st century China and the U.S. China Institute. So two of the most concrete recommendations of this project, which I really enjoyed participating in and learned a lot, are, first of all, to have more track two activity between the United States and China, and then second, to concentrate on the next generation, the younger people, starting as early as we can get them, to try to improve mutual understanding. So I thought I'd just make a couple of remarks about track two diplomacy, because I have been engaged in track two diplomacy since the early 1990s. And at the Institute on Global Conflict and Cooperation of the University of California, we started something called the Northeast Asia Cooperation Dialogue back in 1993, which has the same six countries that are in the six-party talks. Russia, China, Japan, the U.S., North Korea, and South Korea. And one thing, point I'd like to make, because this really speaks to learning and the possibility of improving relationships through track two diplomacy, is that when we founded, we call it NISAD, Northeast Asia Cooperation Dialogue, the North Koreans were more enthusiastic about participating than the Chinese. The Chinese sent a very low-level officer, diplomat from the embassy in Washington. The North Koreans sent a much more senior person. And at the time, China was very reluctant to engage in regional multilateral diplomacy because they feared that everybody would gang up and point fingers at China. And they loved the UN Security Council, enjoyed the status of being one of the P5, but were very reluctant to get involved in regional multilateral activities. But the foreign ministry people from the Asia Department of the Chinese Foreign Ministry, who started coming to this dialogue, soon recognized that participation in track two diplomacy in the Asia-Pacific region could be an excellent way for China to reassure its neighbors and the United States that as its capabilities were growing, its economic capabilities and its military capabilities, that it was not a threat because its intentions were benign, were friendly. And of course, you know, the capability, China's capabilities, growing capabilities are clear for everyone to see. But the question mark, what leads to mistrust, misperceptions, and potentially to direct conflict is the whole question of intentions. And I think track two diplomacy between China and the United States, sometimes including other countries, sometimes just bilateral, is extremely important because based on my experience, what I saw is that Chinese diplomats learned very quickly that they could engage successfully and that this bred a certain confidence and ability to cooperate. Now, you might say, well, look, we have so many official discussions with China nowadays. And it's certainly true that through the strategic and economic dialogue and functional discussions of officials in different kinds of ministries and agencies, we have a lot of official talks. But I can tell you from my experience as a State Department official, and then my experience with the unofficial dialogues in track two diplomacy, that track two diplomacy is so much more candid because the officials come not representing their governments, but representing themselves in a private capacity. And it's a, yes, it's a bit of a fig leaf, because, of course, they're still officials, and they're not going to say things that are, you know, 180 degrees at variance with government policy, but they speak more directly, more candidly, and they therefore help the other side gain a much better understanding of the domestic context for policy on each side. Now, it's wrong to oversell track two diplomacy. Rarely do we have dramatic breakthroughs that lead to a change in the relationship. But over time, bit by bit, relationships are built and understanding is built. And sometimes, you know, there are breakthroughs because sometimes there are more intensive discussions at the margin of Northeast Asia cooperation dialogue, including with the North Koreans in this case, or between the U.S. and China. Now, why is track two diplomacy a good idea for U.S. and China? Because in China now, it's a very pluralistic policy process. When we have dialogues with North Korea, you always have the question, are the real decision makers actually getting the feedback, the information, because they're the deciders, and that's the people you want to influence. But in China, we don't really have to worry about that. Because in China, it's not that one man, Xi Jinping, is making all the decisions. In fact, we have a very pluralistic process, and many people in think tanks, as well as different government agencies, play a role and influence the final decision. So we need to have these kinds of dialogues, engaging people from Beijing University, international relations experts are called in frequently to advise on policy, much more than American academics are, I might say. So those think tanks, as well as the government agencies, do play a role. Another one area where I think we definitely need more unofficial dialogues are in the military defense sector. On when it comes to official talks and the official part of the relationship between our militaries is the thinnest reed in the relationship. Talks or exchange activities between our militaries are the first thing to get canceled. If we don't like something the Chinese side has done, then the U.S. side cancels. If the Chinese side doesn't like something the U.S. has done, they cancel the meeting. It's as if they're so expendable, so unimportant, that they're the first thing to be sacrificed. I think that's a big mistake, because I believe that misperceptions between our two militaries are really quite dangerous. And what I've seen from the Northeast Asia Cooperation Dialogue, we have something called the Defense Information Sharing Study Project, that when the militaries get together, they have a lot to say to one another as professionals, and it really helps them understand what those intentions are, as well as, I mean, they don't share any secret information about capabilities, but it really helps prevent miscalculation between the two sides. And what I really think would be particularly important is track two discussions that include the militaries with the civilian officials together. Because for one thing, that might help improve coordination and understanding on inside China between the military officials and, say, the foreign ministry and other parts of the decision-making apparatus. So, you know, you might think, well, this relationship is so mature, we have so many meetings, that we don't really need any more by way of informal dialogue among policymakers in China and the United States. But I would argue that quite to the contrary, we should intensify our efforts and expand our track two activity between the two sides. Thank you.
So what to do? We thought long and hard about this in the commission, and we came up with three themes that on behalf of the commission I want to share with you. And they're basically the cover of the report. We talk about new generation people, new generation programs, and new generation platforms. And what do we mean by that? I think many of us in this room have had the experience of going into a track two or a public diplomacy conference, and how shall I put this? The group has a particular demographic. They tend to be more senior. And we think there are tremendous opportunities to bring in the next generation of young Americans and the next generation of young Chinese to get to know one another. It's very straightforward, it's not very complicated, but hugely important, not so much for the short-term benefit of the relationship, but the relationship over the long term. Think of the Fulbright program. Think of the Fulbright program. The number of heads of state who have come to the United States when they were young is really quite remarkable. The second point that we emphasize is a new generation of programs. And what do we mean by programs? There's some wonderful work being done by the U.S. State Department and other organizations, which is deeply, deeply underfunded, by the way, deeply underfunded relative to where it should be, even in the traditional programs. But we believe that, in the commission, that we have got to move outside of Beijing and outside of Washington, D.C. to have these second track public diplomacy, people-to-people kinds of discussions. I'm a native-born Washingtonian and I love the city. But there are other areas in the United States that are worth visiting, including my current place like Los Angeles. But if you look at the percentage of work that's being done in Washington, it's disproportionate. And that does not capture the richness and robustness of the culture of either side. The third sort of category, if you will, that we talked about was next generation platforms. And by that we mean that a lot of the exchanges that take place are either face-to-face or other forms of or writing, basically, reports. But it is the case that we now have these things and things that look like slightly larger versions of these things. We have got to find a way to engage with the technology which is now available where we can use things like this virtually for free. So the cost of moving bodies back and forth across the Pacific is much, much greater than the cost of moving ideas and pictures and motion pictures and tweets and blogs back and forth. That in turn reinforces the generational aspect of our recommendation and also buttresses the idea that we can take these discussions outside of Washington and outside of Beijing. And so again, the theme that we think is important, number one is next generation people, next generation programs, and next generation platforms or technologies. Thank you very much, and now my colleagues will address that a bit more.
Dean Wilson just captured most of the gist of the report. I will report to you some of the programs that we have been doing at our school. Actually, we have a very dynamic and lively set of programs going on in terms of, you know, exchange, student exchange, shared education. One is with Cornell University. They are sending a group of 10 to 15 students every year to our school to spend 6 months to a year. And there they get the lectures and also study with Chinese students. And of course, we also sent some PhD students to do research in at Cornell. And of course, we also have students from other institutions coming to our school to study from the U.S. Actually, one of the students was one of the two students introduced the first lady when she visited Beida to give a speech. And he did it in Chinese, I believe. We are very proud of him. and of course, I'm heading this Institute of China-U.S. People-to-people exchange. We sponsor some programs and work with other institutions to set up some young people, youth or youth leaders programs. Okay. Actually, we are now in the process of working with Ambassador Julia Block, who is sitting in the audience, to set up this program for young Chinese postdoc, right? And also early career professionals, and try to engage them in U.S. studies. And also to come to this country for training for some time, we are also working with Shanghai Overseas Chinese Foundation. I think we every year we organize 30 to 40 mid-career Chinese business people, officials, and teachers to come to the U.S. For a two-week visit. We organize some dialogues, symposiums between the Chinese and American youth. We are also in the process of organizing a dialogue between young professionals in the think tanks of the two countries later this year. I think in July, when Secretary Kerry and Vice Premier Liu Yandong was supposed to meet to discuss China-U.S. people-to-people exchange. So we are doing a lot of things, but never enough. We believe that it's everybody's responsibility to do something to make this important relationship better. Yeah, thank you.
I'd like to introduce now a website that's advertised on every page of the report, as well as the back cover of it. One of the things that we were so conscious of as we worked on this project is the lack of a clearinghouse for information about U.S.-China exchanges. There are a number of organizations for a long time, the National Committee on U.S.-China Relations, the Asia Society, our great universities. A lot of organizations for a long time have sponsored exchanges of various sorts. But to learn about any of these exchanges, for the most part, you have to persuade the institution itself to give you that information. And so we set out to create a database that would be accessible to anyone who is interested in all that's going on in the U.S.-China relations. Many of you know that if today was an average day, 6,000 Americans went to China. And if today was an average day, 4,000 Chinese came to the United States, a number that has more than doubled in just a couple of years. So there's a lot going on. And we wanted to convey this. And so we've created a database, which, although it's the most comprehensive available, has holes in it. And so we have an opportunity at the website for you to submit information about exchanges that you know about that we haven't captured. We expect that the database will be used by all sorts of folks, policymakers who are interested, what kind of exchanges are going on about water conservation, about protecting water resources. An issue, of course, it's very much in the news in both countries. And in fact, there are experts in both countries who have been working on it. And in fact, here at the Wilson Center, important work has been done on this very subject. So you can go to this database if you're a policymaker looking to get information about who's working on this field, or perhaps you're a journalist. You're interested in the number of elementary school exchanges. You want to know who are the movers and shakers, perhaps, in cultural exchange. All of that information we are seeking to provide through this publicly accessible database. And so here it is at uschinaexchange.usc.edu. And you just go to the database and you can search. And so you could put in, for example, the name of a state, and you get information about some of the exchanges that involve that U.S. state. You can also search by Chinese location, province or municipality. You can search by date. You can search under topics. If you want everything pertaining to science, that's there. If you want everything on the state-to-state level. It's also possible if you're looking, for example, for city-to-city exchanges. All of that can be acquired at this database. And we hope that you'll start using it maybe a little bit after our session today. But there are holes in it. And we invite those of you who have participated in exchanges to let us know about that, because we want this to be the most comprehensive and therefore the most useful resource for people who want information about this, or perhaps people who want to start exchanges. And rather than reinventing the wheel, they will be able to partner with some folks who are already doing this, and they can learn about the practices employed by the most effective of these exchanges. So you can find out what works and maybe get some suggestion about what doesn't. So I invite you to check out uschinaexchange.usc.edu. Now, Dean Jha just mentioned some of the great programs that he's been working on at Beijing University. Professor Shirk was very kind. She could have gone on for 30 minutes about the kinds of things that are going on between UCSD, Fudan University, and a whole host of other institutions in China. I'm going to resist the temptation to talk about all the great things that are happening at the University of Southern California. There are a dozen programs this summer that will involve U.S. students going to China and other programs bringing professionals and students to our campus in Los Angeles and to elsewhere. But we won't go on to that. Instead, what I'd like to do is just give you a short example of one exchange that highlights some of the themes in this report. So you've heard, for example, the deans talk about the importance of focusing on youth. That's not just simply because we're all at universities and that's the game we play. It's also because, as you see in the survey, people under 30 in both countries are the only ones where at least half of those polled had a favorable impression of the other place. Older people become more cynical, more negative towards the other country. And so this is where the game needs to be played. And so we're paying attention to that. We want to use new technologies because that saves money and it allows for the extension of the activity. The exchange doesn't need to be confined to 1 week, to 2 weeks, a single month, or even a year. You can foster exchanges without regard to the time distance challenge. And that's something that's very important. And it allows for other people to be brought in. And so the example I've got for you here is of an exchange involving students from Communication University of China and the University of Southern California School for Cinematic Arts. Every year, a half dozen students travel from one school to the other, and it bounces between Beijing and Los Angeles. The students come together, and they are forced into a shotgun marriage. In just a couple hours, we pair them up and say, go make a movie. They have 5 weeks, these pairs of students, one Chinese, one American, to work together to communicate something important about whatever city it happens that they're in. They have to solve a problem to come together to communicate something effectively. And we have these available at our website at the U.S. China Institute, but we also have them available at our YouTube channel. They've been screened on the documentary channel in China and screened also on documentary channels here in the United States. These documentaries are short, 10 minutes each roughly, but we don't even have enough time to play even one full one. But let me tease you just a bit. The first is called Children of the Sun. And the reason for choosing this one is it focuses on an NGO in China that addresses the problem of how to care for the children of incarcerated parents. Most Americans have no idea that such an institution exists. Many Chinese don't even know about this. These two filmmakers go to one of these places, Taiyangcun, and they made a film about this little boy.
2007年9月9日，爸爸在家中忙，所以我就到这儿了。你爸什么时候接你走啊？他6年级毕业。6年级毕业就接你走？你想住这儿还是想回去？住这儿呗。啊？住这儿呗。
So our little friend here, he doesn't know if he wants to be a painter or a scientist. He knows he's here because his father's in jail. He doesn't know why his father's in jail. His father is in jail because he murdered his mother. He murdered the boy's mother. And so the film goes on to talk with the caregivers, the folks who take care of this facility and this boy, and they're talking about, well, should we tell him, should we not, these sorts of things. I really invite you to go to the website, take a look at this. It's really a compelling video. It should be on television tonight. It talks about a place and people, a very serious social problem, and how it's being addressed. This was an American student and a Chinese student getting together to tell this story. Now, there are dozens of these videos available at our website. We don't have time, sadly, to see many more of them. But let me show you the most popular one of all time, How to Get an American Girlfriend. And you know, feel free to take notes. This, on our YouTube channel, it's only received 1,600 views, but it was posted in China on 56.com, where it received more than 1 million views. This is an unusual film because the filmmaker is also, he puts himself front and center. Friends, How to Get an American Girlfriend.
I came to Los Angeles from China 1 year ago. In the afternoon on June 1st, 2011, I sat outside of the Starbucks at Hollywood for half an hour. During that day, more than 300 American females passed by me without saying, hello, hi, or may I have your number? I feel like I'm a wolf, living with tons of sheep. But I cannot eat for some reason. What is the reason? I do not know, but I do know. I need to find the answer.
To find this answer, I decided to interview some of my friends. Listening to girls' idea is always a good way.
我觉得中国男生一点都不穷哎，我觉得 U.S.C 的富二代、官二代太多了。就只要一般的，就是你只要家庭可以自费，尤其像我们读 master， 基本都是自己家里面出钱。而且那些富二代嘛，开跑车，各种各样，他们就真的绝对是比美国男生有钱的。但是他们同样 dating 不到。
Yeah, I know I've disappointed you by shutting it off, but we have many to see the solution to this. I invite you again to check out the U.S. China Institute website or to visit our YouTube channel to take a look at it there or to go online and in China where this is one of the most popular videos ever posted by a student. Just to cut to the chase, over time he discovers maybe he shouldn't be looking for an American girlfriend. Maybe he should be looking for a nice person. Maybe he should be getting out of these categories. This, of course, is not discussing the Diaoyudao Senkaku issue. This is not talking about trade sanctions. This is not talking about those things. It's talking about something that mattered to the students who made this. And they bring their ideas together and express them in this creative way. And so we believe that one of the issues is not just that, you know, certainly these big geopolitical strategic questions are important. Our economic relationship that has been the foundation carrying us through difficult times in the past, we have run into some problems, of course. We believe those things matter, but we believe that all of the good work that's being done to address real problems, for example, in urban planning, sanitation, road management, this is going on in cities across the United States and cities across China. Every day that kind of cooperation goes on. We believe that those exchanges deserve attention too. And one purpose for our database, one purpose for this commission, is to draw attention to that. Friends, we turn now to one of the most important commentators on the U.S.-China relationship, not just today, but for decades. When the U.S.-China Institute was founded in 2006, we began planning our first conference for 2007, and we said, who should we invite to be the keynote speaker? And by universal acclaim, we settled on Ambassador Stapleton Roy, and then spent months begging him to do it. We're so very, very honored to have him with us today to comment on the efforts represented in this report and the U.S.-China relationship more generally. Friends, Ambassador Stapleton Roy.
I'm going to speak sitting down. My original intention was to distinguish myself from the stand-up speakers, because all of the stand-up speakers were directly involved with this report in some fashion, and I have no connection to the report. But then Clayton chose to speak sitting down, and this has destroyed my concept. But I think this last movie was very useful, because I think there's no question. We're here to discuss this report on building U.S.-China trust. And if every American male had a Chinese girlfriend, and if every Chinese male had an American girlfriend, we'd of course have a problem of supply and demand, but it probably would enhance trust between the two countries, but it wouldn't enhance trust within marriages. and that illustrates that the issue of building trust is a very complex issue. And while I had nothing to do with the preparation of this report, I've read it, and it's an excellent report, and it deals with a central topic in U.S. foreign policy, which is the question of managing U.S.-China relations. Both sides are concerned at the fact that mutual mistrust is increasing, and the question is, how does one deal with that problem? Now, I can speak as a practitioner rather than as a theoretician on this question. My experience has been that the principal driver of international behavior is national interest, not mutual trust. But trust is important. Non-coercive international agreements, I'm careful to specify, non-coercive, these are reached by mutual agreement, negotiated in good faith, are based on overlapping national interests. But they enhance mutual trust by providing a measure of assurance that countries will behave in the manner specified in the agreement. I'll get into this a little bit more. International agreements become unreliable guides to behavior when one country's perception of its national interest diverges from the commitments made in the agreement. In other words, if national interest does not support compliance with agreements, you cannot count on the reliability of the agreement. And it's important to understand these considerations. History is replete with instances of agreements that were not negotiated in good faith, or whether the domestic basis for compliance was insufficiently strong. U.S. immigration treaties with China in the 19th century is a good case in point. In one case, we negotiated an immigration treaty. We had difficulty implementing it. We revised it to provide for more limitations on immigration. And within 6 months of that agreement coming into effect, the Chinese Exclusion Act was passed, which banned Chinese immigration for the next 50-some years. So here was a case where domestic basis for compliance was simply insufficiently strong. In other words, the government really was wrong to negotiate the agreements because it couldn't live up to them. You could equally apply that to the U.S. agreements with American Indians during our period of Western expansion. Numerous treaties negotiated, all of them violated, because the pressures for westward expansion were simply stronger than the commitments that the U.S. government could undertake in the agreements that it was negotiating. But this is the type of behavior that does not enhance mutual trust, and it gave rise, of course, in our history to the statement, white man speaks with forked tongue, which was the Indian reaction to the fact that the U.S. government was not seen as reliable in living up to its commitments. Other examples you could cite, the Hitler-Stalin Non-Aggression Pact of August 1939. Now, probably that was negotiated in bad faith, and it lasted less than 2 years before Nazi Germany chose to violate the agreement by invading the Soviet Union in June of 1941. But in the case of the Japanese Soviet Non-Aggression Pact of April 1941, it actually stabilized the front between the Soviet Union and Japan for 4 years. But then the Soviets denounced the treaty at the beginning of 1945, and it had a year to run out, but the Soviet Union attacked Japan less than 6 months before that process had borne it out. So they didn't live up to the agreement. Probably there was no mutual trust between the two sides. The reason it even existed was because it was in the national interest of the two sides to not get into the direct conflict, and that broke down at the end of the war, and as a result, the agreement was worthless. Now, what do we mean by trust? The report states that strategic trust in bilateral relations and concerning international issues means that the sides recognize that their common interests outweigh their differences. I would define the issue somewhat differently. Trust in international affairs represents confidence that the other side will do what it says, that it will adhere to its commitments, and that it is not deliberately misleading you as to its intentions. Now, I debated whether to say not deliberately misleading you as to its capabilities and intentions, and I decided not to include capabilities in my statement because most countries are not transparent with respect to their capabilities. They exaggerate their strengths and they hide their weaknesses. That's normal international behavior and it doesn't really generate mistrust. But if you hide your intentions or if you mislead the other side with respect to your intentions, it has a devastating impact on mutual trust. You also have to distinguish between trust between governments and trust between nations or peoples. This report is not that relevant to the first. It is very relevant to the second. And there's a direct connection to the two. Because if you don't have a base of trust between the peoples of two countries, governments find that their room for maneuver in terms of dealing with the other country is restricted. A classic case in point occurred in the first Gulf War when Jordan, neighboring to Iraq, was cooperating with the Bush administration, but the people of Jordan were sympathetic to Saddam Hussein in Iraq. Now, President Bush understood the problem. And as a result, he did not let Jordan's inability to cooperate with us where we would normally have expected cooperation damage the bilateral relationship because he understood these considerations. This is atypical international behavior. Frequently, governments will get angry because other governments don't behave the way we want them to because we don't understand that they can't behave that way. We see a variant of this, not a very good variant, but I'll touch on it in the Ukraine situation, where Putin has overwhelming support from the Russian people in terms of what he's done with respect to Crimea, And we see it as an act of bad faith on his part because it's a direct violation of an earlier agreement between the Russians and the Ukrainian government with respect to Crimea. But of course, if you ask Putin about it, he would refer to the fact that the American president and the American Secretary of State gave Russia assurances when the Russian Soviet Union was unraveling that NATO would not be expanded into former Soviet territories, and we then turned around and violated those agreements. So this is typical of the type of behavior that undermines mutual trust at the government level. But you need that base of support for stable management of wise policies. And that's why the issues addressed in this report are so important, because we don't have that stable base in either China or the United States at the present time. It's not all negative. If you read the report, you will find that, in fact, in both countries, there may even be more than 50% support or positive views about the other country. But the level is not sufficiently strong to overcome the areas where our strategic rivalry is driving us in directions of mutual mistrust. The types of issues that are important in terms of enhancing mutual trust are not addressed in this report. Let me just quickly give you a sense of the types of behaviors that have damaged U.S.-China mistrust. And here, I'm not talking about the rightness or wrongness of behavior. I'm simply saying that they damaged mutual trust. An example, the U.S. sale of F-16 aircraft to Taiwan in 1992. China saw that as a direct violation of the commitments made by the United States in the August 17, 1982 joint communique between the two governments. The U.S. government didn't see it that way, but it had a damaging impact on trust between our two governments. But the damage was not as severe as 3 years later when the United States suddenly reversed itself after giving repeated assurances to the Chinese government that we would not permit the president of Taiwan to make a private visit to the United States. And then at the last minute, we reversed ourselves. And the consequences of that reversal were much more severe than the F-16 sale to Taiwan, because China changed its basic approach to Taiwan by beginning to use threats of force because it no longer believed that the United States was reliable in sticking to a one-China policy. So in other words, here was a catastrophic collapse of mutual trust because of an action by the U.S. government that the U.S. government did not see as really that significant. This is an example of where understanding of the other side's position was inadequate, and it therefore affected matters. U.S. cyber attacks on Tsinghua University, for example, when those became public knowledge, undercut our position in arguing with China that going after business secrets was inappropriate, because the Chinese cyber attacks on American companies, which had reached catastrophic scales, was very damaging to the attitudes in the American business community toward the Chinese, and we were claiming that we don't do that sort of thing, and then it turns out that we were going after China's MIT, Caltech rolled into one in Tsinghua University. U.S. relations with Japan. China is inclined to see that as being directed against China, whereas both the United States and Japan actually have strong interests in cooperating with China. But the perception is there. The same thing could be said about the U.S. rebalancing strategy. But it's not all on this side. Chinese theft of intellectual property, even though we have firm agreements regarding protection of intellectual property, means that in the U.S. business community, there is no trust of the Chinese on the issue of protecting intellectual property. I've mentioned the cyber attacks. China's relations with North Korea. Some people understand why China behaves the way it does with respect to North Korea, but most Americans don't. And when they see how China sort of plays both sides of the thing, sanctioning North Korea on the one hand, but also probably having the most access and contacts with the North Korean government on the other hand, they see this as devious behavior and they wonder whether the Chinese are really serious about China's, about North Korea's nuclear weapons program. You can see elements of this also in the China-Russian relationship. So in other words, these are areas where the two governments need to bring their words and their behavior patterns into better conformity with each other, or you can't create mutual trust at the strategic level. Let's look at an area where I have some personal experience, which is trust in ambassadors. An ambassador is trusted if he or she is seen as a reliable conduit for conveying the views of one government to the other government. Some ambassadors don't do it well. They distort it. You give them a message, the feedback suggests that the other government didn't understand what your message was. Well, if that occurs, a government won't use the ambassador to convey messages anymore. And the same thing will apply if the American government has an American ambassador abroad that it doesn't trust to convey the message properly to the other side. A critically important example of this is Ambassador Dobrynin, the Soviet ambassador here for over 25 years during the height of the Cold War. He had the confidence of the U.S. side. He had intimate access to the topmost U.S. officials because he was seen as a reliable conduit for getting top-level confidential views of the U.S. leaders to the Soviet government. We never had an ambassador in the Soviet Union during that period who had the access to top Soviet leaders necessary to be a reliable conduit for conveying views. They were very good at assessing Soviet behavior, but they weren't seen as reliable conduits. So the trust rested in Ambassador Dobrynin rather than in the American ambassador. Ambassadors are not expected to agree with the views of the host government in conveying their views to their own government, but they are expected not to distort them. And that's very important. And if an ambassador loses the trust of the local government, the effectiveness of the ambassador will be badly eroded. But the same thing applies to senior government officials. If you say one thing and do another, you lose the confidence of the other government, and it contributes to mutual mistrust. In my experience, I have seen American officials who were unwilling to carry out commitments, and I've seen Chinese officials who were unwilling to carry out commitments. In many cases, their unwillingness to carry out the commitments was not a reflection of policy. It was simply they were in power positions, and they chose to behave that way, and they damaged mutual trust in the process. So therefore, mutual trust also requires coordinated government actions so that the behavior of officials reflects the intentions of the government. And if you have arbitrary behavior by officials, you lose confidence that the other government can carry out its obligations and commitments. So these are very important questions, and the two are linked together. If you have government trust without people trust, your policy will not rest on solid ground. And the same is true if you have a lack of trust at the governmental level, even though the people are getting along well together, that can still create major problems. So I think this is a very important area that we need to be giving attention to. But the issue of trust is not a simple one. It's a very complex one, and it really rests on the question of, do I trust you to do what you say or are trying to convey to me you are intending to do? And if it turns out that's not the case, trust flies out the window. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, now you know why we wanted so desperately to have Ambassador Roy speak in 2007 and again here today. On behalf of the commission, I want to thank him for those comments, and also I think we can readily accept his friendly amendment to the definition of what matters in trust. We need to get words and actions aligned. There has to be predictability. And that, he highlighted the point about building capacity, building a foundation. And that's what we are seeking to do here.